Hey y'all, my name is Prashant Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be doing a passage walkthrough in the MCAT Psych Soc section. You should be taking roughly 6.5 minutes on this passage, but today, we're going to be going more in depth so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as I take on this section. Let's get it! Alright, great. So I've gone ahead and put the passage on the left and the questions on the right. So feel free to take a moment and pause the video and come back to us when you're ready. If not, let's get right into talking strategy. For me, I like to maintain the same exact strategy regardless of where I'm looking at, whatever passage, whatever section. The reason for this is it gives me something to come back to regardless of whether the passage is super easy or super hard. Having this routine builds confidence, and confidence is imperative for the MCAT. Additionally, I like to read a paragraph, write a quick 3 to 5 word summary, and then go on to the next paragraph. Doing this makes sure I understand what's going on in that paragraph before progressing to the next one. That 3 to 5 word summary isn't too important, but it's a quick check-in to make sure I understand exactly what's going on. Additionally, I'm not going to spend too much time on the figures on that first read because I don't know what's going to happen in the questions, right? Maybe the figure's not even asked about. Why would I spend more time than I have to? And if I'm going to have to come back, might as well look at the question and then come back if needed. With that, let's get right into the passage. Recent studies have shown that television can adversely impact cognitive processes in both children and young adults. In previous studies, researchers found that in individuals aged 6 to 23, higher than average amounts of television watching led to an 8 to 14% decrease in the ability of participants to quickly and correctly solve math problems. In addition, participants were less likely to recall list items or accurately identify emotions on a confederate during an in-person experiment. All right, so my question I always ask myself at the end of a paragraph is, what's happening, right? What is happening in this paragraph? And so in three to five quick words or quick summaries, easy English, what's happening? And so I'm going to write question, TV on cognition, right? So that's the question they're asking. They're asking, is there an effect of watching TV on cognition? And with that, I'm not spending too much time on the details. I know I mentioned previous studies and all that, but we'll come back to that if needed. All right, on to the next paragraph. A group of researchers is specifically interested in studying the effect of television on memory. The researchers recruit at least 50 participants in each of the following age groups, 6 to 8, 9 to 11, 12 to 14, and 15 to 17. Each of the participants watches 15 hours of TV per week, as confirmed by the participants themselves and a guardian. The participants watch a range of television programming throughout the week. All right, so now what is happening in this question, right? The same exact question, what's happening? And here we see that researchers are looking at 50 participants into age groups watching TV. Okay? So same thing, right? We're focused on what's happening in the experimental setup, but we see that television, memory, and age groups. So right now we're starting an experimental setup. To conduct the experiment, the researchers split up the participants in each age group into group one or group two. The group one participants watch 15 hours of TV a week for 3 consecutive weeks. At the end of the third week, the participants are brought into a testing center and given a list of 20 names. 10 minutes later, they are asked to recall as many names as possible. The group 1 participants then watch 15 hours of TV a week for the next 3 consecutive weeks and repeat the memory assessment. Group 2 participants follow an identical plan as group 1 participants for weeks 1 through 3. However, during weeks 4 through 6, group 2 participants are not allowed to watch any TV during the week. Group 2 participants complete the same memory test as group 1 students at the end of week 3 and at the end of week 6. The results from the experiment are shown in figure 1 for the 9 to 11 year old age group. Alright, so right away we see all of these details. A super complicated experimental setup, right? So let's think about what's happening first, right? There's two groups, so I'm going to draw what's happening. Two groups, right? 1 and 2. And then what happens? I'm just going to say there's a 1 through 3 and 4 through 6, right? TV, TV, right? They both start with TV. And then one goes to TV and two goes to no TV, right? I'm not going to focus too much time on this, but this nice little diagram gives us everything we need from that passage for the first sort of glance. If we need to come back to the details, if we need to come back to the hours of TV, we know where to come back to. But with that, we can go right onto our figure. And we see with our figure that there's a graph. I want you to give a quick look at the axes, the legend maybe, but nothing too significant, right? We see that there's two tests on that x-axis, and then on the y, it's the number of names recalled, and then it's color-coded by the groups. So right away, we have a quick understanding of the graph. I'm not going to spend more than a few seconds on it, and we're ready to go right into our questions. So let's do it. One, in a follow-up study, researchers found that participants are best able to recall names at the end of the list better than names at the beginning of the list. This is known as A, recency effect, B, proactive interference, C, primacy effect, or D, retroactive interference. All right, so right away we see this is a standalone question, so we don't have to spend too much time going through the passage. But this requires us to know the terms that we're talking about. So if we're able to do what? We're able to recall names at the end of the list better than the beginning. What is that, right? If we have a list of numbers like 1, 2, 3, 7, 8, 10, right? It's saying we're going to know these guys more than these guys. All right. So if we're looking at the later numbers, that's going to be called the recency effect, right? It's more recent in our memory, so we're going to remember it much better. That is opposite to the primacy effect. The primacy effect would say the first numbers we say out loud, or the first numbers in the list, we're going to remember better. And that would be these ones up here. But we're not focused on that, so we're going to eliminate C. Now we have two types of interferences, and these are very important terminologies, often confusing. Interference is the idea of some memories getting in the way of understanding other memories or helping remember other memories. And the way you remember which is which is a simple little trick, right? If you're looking retroactive, right? Retro, 80s, old-timey, that type of vibe, right? We're looking backwards, okay? So if I had, I'm going to write new memories and then old memories. If we're having retroactive interference, we're looking backwards, so our new memories are impacting our old memories. So they're getting in the way of remembering old facts, right? And so this is a common thing, right? When you're starting to, after you've like lived in a new house or new building for a while, you start to forget that old address, for example. And so that's because you've spent so much time memorizing this new sort of address. The proactive interference is the opposite, right? To be proactive, you're going to have, I'm going to do this one in blue. Proactive is looking forward, right? You're trying to be proactive in the future. So that means old memories are going to get in the way of new memories. So with that, we know that old memories would get in the way of new memories. And that's often like, oh, I can't remember exactly what my phone number is because I've spent so much time memorizing my old phone number. And so with that, we know that these two aren't true because it doesn't say anything about old memories getting in the way of new memories. Rather, it's saying we're able to recall names at the end of the list better than the beginning of the list. So with that, we're one for one, and we're ready to go on to the next question. And my one tip for these sections is that you should, if you see all these terms, you should know all the terms in the answer choices by heart. The AMC pulls from a pool of sort of terms. If you know all the terms, it's going to make your life so much easier on test day. So on to question number two. Which of the following did the researchers not account for in the study? Is it A, intergroup variability, B, amount of TV watched, C, genre of TV watched, or D, age? All right, so right away we remember our second paragraph, right? We're talking about our second paragraph, and we see that we're looking at the effects of television on memory, and we split them into these age groups, right? 6 to 8, 9 through 11, 15 to 17. And so if we're controlling for, and accounting for in the study, right? We're looking for something. That means we should be looking for something. We're looking for something that's not accounted for in the study, right? So we're looking for something that's not mentioned as a part of the study significantly, right? And so right away, we see age is one of the things that is mentioned, right? We see eight, they stratify by age, so already we're good to go. Next, we see each of the participants in watches 15 hours of TV per week as confirmed by the participants, right? So what else is controlled or looked at by the study, right? The amount of TV watch, right? This is a fixed amount that they put into the study experimental design, so we know it's accounted for. Next, we see that the participants watch a range of television programming throughout the week, right? So if it's a range of television programming, then it's not accounted for in the study. We don't know what the participants are watching. We don't know what they're like looking at, right? So that means genre is not being accounted for in the study. Now we come to this word intergroup variability. And that means, okay, we have these groups one and two, right? How do we make sure that we're accounting for any individualized differences between group one and group two, whether some of them might have lower memory or some of them might be higher memory, just in general? So the way we're looking at intergroup variability is that this first phase, right? We have these first phase where group one participants watch 15 hours, right? And then group two participants also watch, followed identical plan for the first weeks, right? They're both watching TV in that first 1 through 3 weeks to control for that intergroup variability. We want to know, oh, do these students have higher memory in general or lower memory in general in this group? And by doing this, we're able to account for that. So intergroup variability is just looking at that. We have two groups. Is there any differences in the groups themselves without the experimental design getting into play? So with that, we're 2 for 2. All right, question number 3. Which of the following conclusions is not supported by the results shown in figure 1? Is it A, group 1 and 2 participants recall a similar number of names when they watch 15 hours of TV a week? B, retroactive interference prevents group 1 participants from performing as well as group 2 participants on the week 6 test? C, the ability of group 2 participants to recall names improved on the week 6 test? Or D, the number of names recalled by participants is associated with time spent watching TV. All right, so this requires us to go to figure one, right? It tells us that we're looking for figure one and which of the following conclusions are not supported by the results, right? So not supported, we're looking for something that is not supported. So let's start with A. Group one and two participants recall a similar number of names when they watch 15 hours of TV a week. So right away, when we see group one participants watching 15 hours a week, which column are we looking at? We're looking at this one, right? They start by watching 15 hours a week, and week two participants also watch 15 hours a week at this point. So we have to look at these two and say, are they watching a similar amount of TV? Yes, right? There's no statistical significance in between there. And so already we can eliminate A because they do recall a similar number of names when they're both watching 15 hours of TV a week. All right. Now on to B. Retroactive interference prevents group 1 participants from performing as well as group 2 participants on the week 6 test. Okay, so we do see that there is some sort of difference, right? Retroactive interference prevents group 1. Are group 1 participants performing as well as group 2 participants on the week 2 test? No, they're not, right? We see that there's a statistical difference between group 1 and group 2, right? So already there is a change from the week three test to the week six test. But what does that mean? We can't bring any additional information into the passage, right? While there is a change in the amount of TV being watched, right? Or the amount of names being recalled, can we attribute this to retroactive interference? We can't. We don't know that this is true. So for now, we're going to mark this, right? It just says retroactive interference prevents group one participants. What if it's not retroactive interference? What if it's the fact that TV is changing the firing of neurons in your brain? What if it's the fact that these people at week 3 through 6 are not focused on these memory-oriented tasks when they're watching TV, right? We don't know the cause, and we can't assume the cause, so we can't choose a B as our supported yet. All right, C. The ability of group 2 participants to recall names improved on the week 6 test, right? We see that significant difference, right? We see that change of going from here to here. So we're able to eliminate C as our answer choice. All right, D, the number of names recalled by participants is associated with time spent watching TV, right? So same thing, right? If we see a statistically significant change, right, between two groups, we're seeing some sort of association. Do we know whether it's a strong association or a weak association? No, we don't. But we do see that there is some improvement in group two when they do watch TV, when they stop watching TV. So we can eliminate D. And so with that, we know B is our strongest answer. The retroactive interference is not mentioned, and we can't bring outside information into the passage. So just because group one participants perform as well as group two participants, right, don't perform as well, we can't say it's because of retroactive interference. So with that, we've used process of elimination. We've also used some piece of information in the passage, which is a two-pronged approach to getting a question right. On to the final question. Which of the following best describes this type of study described in the passage? Is it A, an observational study, B, an experimental study, C, a case study, or D, a survey study? All right, so let's think. What are each of these studies? Remember when I said if a question asks a term-based question, we need to know all the terms from the answer choices. So first, let's start with, what is an observational study? An observational study is something where there's no intervention into the population, right? You're just looking at a group of population or people, and we're describing effects or describing some sort of pattern in the population. So we can eliminate A because we have an experimental setup. We have some intervention. And so B is looking like our best answer, right? We have an intervention, aka the number of hours of TV watched, that we're looking at the dependent variable, which is the number of names recalled. So this is a classic experimental study. C, a case study, is usually looking at one or maybe a few individual people with specific cases, right? So a case study is often looking at someone with a specific prognosis or a specific type of disease. So that is not the case here because, again, we have more than one or two people and we're not doing a specific description of that one person. We're doing a group-based experimental study. And finally, a survey study is something where you ask participants a bunch of questions and they analyze the results after that. So that's a sort of survey, distribute results type of thing. And that is not the case here. We're giving out no survey. And with that, we're 4 for 4. We crushed it. Great work, team. All right, great work, team. We crushed another psych-sos passage together. Kudos for you for getting it done. Remember, if there's terms used in the answer choices, it's your job to memorize them by the end of the passage. Get them done, learn them by heart, so you can crush the actual test. If you like this video, give us a like down below and subscribe to our channel. And check out our 528 strategy series by Vikram for strategies on how to maximize your score on test day. And finally, click the link in our bio for our MCAT question of the day so you don't miss out on any practice before test day. Happy studying, and let's get it.